for a moment, the IPO, the excitement, the exuberance of some companies that are VC-backed becoming public. What does that mean when you're writing a Series A check?
Thanks, Caroline. Thanks, Ed, for having me on. It's incredibly exciting. I mean, to unlock the IPO markets really then unlocks the growth market, which as an early stage investor, ultimately, that's what we're looking for. And there's Instacart, Klaviyo's tonight. And then we think there's a significant pipeline of really great companies that will unlock after that. So it's very exciting. And the best companies go public. And so we are always, as VCs, investing in early stage, looking for those generational companies to go IPO.
Is it really that much of a domino effect? So you see several companies go public. If you are a startup's done series A, B, C, D, E through M, does that open up the opportunity then for you to do a big growth stage round because there's more money going into public markets as well?
It all trickles from the public markets. And so the growth investors that fund our companies need to return capital to their investors. We all have to return capital to our investors. And the way that the momentum will work is with the IPOs that will start to unlock. They'll start to return capital. And then they can invest that new fresh funds into our companies, which is going to be required ultimately to get them to the scale that a Klaviyo or an Instacart is today.
I'm fascinated by valuations at all end of the curve for startups. You know, those names that have gone public in this past week really emphasized artificial intelligence as if it was going to help them out. Is the same thing happening at the other end in early stage where you attach AI to your domain name, your valuation goes up?
That happens. We're very sensitive to that as a firm. You know, we really believe in hype cycles and being very sensitive to where we are in hype cycles. But hype cycles can be a good thing. In AI, you know, it allows for boardroom conversations and budgets to open up, and that can really help our companies. But we're very sensitive to the valuations that early stage companies can attach and making sure that the founders that are building these companies really have domain expertise in AI and have a clear path to show how the AI is going to enable some product or service that can service the end customer.
And everyone's been trying to push that forward. Like, where is the disruption coming? Which industry groups? Legal, clear. But healthcare has been time and time again referenced. Is that something that you're focusing in on?
Yeah, it's a big focus for our firm and for me personally. If you look at healthcare in this country, it's $4 trillion of spend, nearly 20% of GDP. And I think we're really still in the very early days of the digital transformation. So we've, at the firm, invested in really innovative care delivery models around new areas of medicine, like Form, which is a market leader in obesity. And we've spent a lot of time now focusing in on how can you use AI to really support clinicians and health systems to drive better care and ultimately better outcomes for patients. And that's really always our end goal, is how can you deliver better outcomes and simultaneously rip costs out of the system.
I mean, we had a VC on from Underscore VC yesterday based in Boston. We're thinking of Fuji Simo and her team at Instacart celebrating in San Francisco today. Does it matter where these founders, where these businesses are being cultivated, being born? How are you getting access to all of them?
Founders can be built, you know, anywhere. We'll go anywhere to find the best founders. Ultimately, what we're focused on is founders that have real domain expertise. And so I'd love to give you an example of a company we just announced called Carenostics, which is providing localized AI for health systems. And so it ingests the healthcare data of any healthcare system.
Yes.
And by doing so, it's able to detect diseases much earlier. So of the $4 trillion of spend in the US, 90% of it is because chronic diseases go undiagnosed. And so they've shown and have great data to show that chronic kidney disease, for example, they can identify 3 times the number of patients. They can identify 20 times the number of asthma patients much earlier on. And this can really drive tremendous, you know, health spans and lifespans for patients. And that to us is really, really critical. So we'll go anywhere, but ultimately in the case of this company, the CEO is based in Philadelphia. So I took the short train ride over and sat down and you know, we did a deal. And that company, the founder, we think is a leading AI expert in the world.